This day is a day that is known in the world as Christmas. And while I don't generally cater to preaching special sermons dealing with holidays, especially religious holidays, there are times in which I think is good to take advantage of a state of mind to teach some needed lessons. And although the denominational world is observing today as the day of Christ or his birthday, we do not advance such an idea. Many times the religious world wonders why, thinks it strange that we do not, as if we were somehow anti-Christ or anti-Christian. And that, of course, is not the case. But there are some good reasons for not doing so. And while this lesson isn't going to be directed toward Christmas and its observance, most authorities do agree that this date could not be the birthday of our Lord. It's the height of the rainy season in Judea. And this fact alone does not coincide with biblical or secular account of his birth. It just doesn't. In fact, Christmas is paganistic in its origin. It's the outgrowth of the heathen observance of winter solstice as the birthday of the sun, or the sun god Mithra. I hope I pronounced that right, but if not, well, hopefully you'll know what it is. It was not observed, or Christmas was not observed, as December 25th until Liberius, the Bishop of Rome, ordered that December 25th be observed as the birthday of Christ in 354. So for all of that period of time, actually they observed Christmas a little bit before that, but there was a variation as to when it was observed. And finally Liberius ordered it's going to be December 25th. While we could go through and show all of the paganistic origins of many of the things associated with Christmas, in reality, the main reason we do not observe Christmas religiously is that there is simply no authority for such. The song that we just sang, "Do All in the Name of the Lord," is a good song that expresses the idea that we need to keep in the forefront of our minds. As we look for the authority in the Bible, there very simply is no direct statement. There is nothing as far as implication, nor an example, to observe any day as the birth of Christ. Thus we don't. Is it thus wrong to do so? What? John would write that whosoever transgresseth and abideth not in the doctrine of Christ hath not God. He that abideth in the doctrine of Christ, he hath both the Father and the Son. Thus, to observe in a religious way December 25th as the birth of Christ is to not remain within the doctrine of Christ. It is going beyond, it's transgressing that doctrine. And those who do such do not have God, is what John says. God has given us, we've noticed this passage many times through the years, 2 Peter 1 and verse 3, all things that pertain to life and godliness. Yet he did not give us either a date or even the idea of celebrating the birth of Christ in a religious way. if it was not given to us to observe that, then it must not be a part of life and godliness. In reality, the practice of anything religiously that's not taught by Christ is thus wrong. Mentioned Colossians 3 and verse 17 in conjunction with that song, do all in the name of the Lord. Well, it is, very simply, everything that we do, whatsoever you do, word or deed, do all in the name of the Lord Jesus. There's the authority of Christ that we must have for everything that we do. In Matthew 15 and verse 9, we're told that in vain do they worship me, teaching for doctrine the commandments of men. Since it is not a part of the doctrine of Christ, it is only a part of the doctrine of men, and thus it would make our worship vain to celebrate December 25th or any day as the birthday of our Lord. We do recognize, of course, that the birth of Christ into this world was a great event. But we are commanded by God to observe His death. We do that in partaking of the Lord's Supper upon the first day of the week, Acts 20 and verse 7. But we're never commanded to observe His birth. Thus, the religious significance that is attached to this date of December 25th is wrong. But, and here's what our lesson is going to center around, the characteristic spirit of this day is certainly good and should be promoted and should ever be manifested within our lives as Christians. And if we look at that spirit, one of the top aspects of the spirit of Christmas is that of the spirit of giving. When we think of Christmas, we think of a time of giving. Friends, relatives, loved ones get together and they exchange gifts. There is that exchange of giving, of gifts and giving something to someone who's a loved one. And sometimes even congregations will get together and give baskets of food or packages to the poor or to the needy, things such as that. Many individuals will realize the need to give more liberally to the church in time of Christmas, because it is that spirit of giving that has come within their life, and thus they give more. Contributions many times will go up during this time of the year. All of this is fine and good. It is certainly an aspect that should be promoted. But should it be promoted only at this time of the year? Shouldn't it prevail all of the year round at all times of the Christian life? Jesus stated in Matthew 26 and verse 11 that the poor ye have always with you, but me ye have not always. Poor is always going to be here. They always need help. They always need that beneficial gift. We need to be benevolent toward them. In that scene of the judgment in Matthew the 25th chapter, verses 31 through verse 46, those individuals are judged based upon the aspect that Jesus says, I was hungry, you gave me meat. I was thirsty, you gave me drink. I was a stranger, you took me in. Naked, you clothed me. Sick, you visited me. Prisoner, you came unto me. And of course, those on the right hand did those things. Those who are on his left hand did not do those things. But many of the things that are listed here are very simply the attitude of giving. Those who are on the right hand demonstrated that attitude of giving, while those on the left hand failed to do so. And thus, they were going to be the ones who would be hearing those words, depart from me, cursed into everlasting fire prepared for the devil and his angels. and they would go away into everlasting punishment. The righteous, those who had that spirit of giving, would go into life eternal. And so it is an aspect that is needful for those who are Christians to have that attitude of a giving type of attitude. We're talking about the church. Contributions to the church should not be just a, well, it's a Christmas, so I need to give to the church now. But it needs to be a regular thing. In 1 Corinthians 16, verses 1 and verse 2, as Paul says, concerning the collection of the saints, as I have given order unto the churches of Galatia, even so do ye, upon the first day of the week. Not at Christmas time, not once a year, but upon the first day of the week, let every one of you lay by him in store, as God has prospered him, that there be no gatherings when I come. And so here, on a weekly basis, there was that command, that order that Paul was giving, you put money into that common treasury, the treasury of the church. And then, as he would write the second epistle to the Corinthians, and encouraging them to fulfill this duty, he says in chapter 9, verses 6 and verse 7, but this I say, he which soweth sparingly shall reap also sparingly. He that soweth bountifully shall reap also bountifully. Every man according as he purposeth in his heart, so let him give, not grudgingly or of necessity, for God loveth a cheerful giver. We are to be a cheerful giver. But we are to give liberally, not sparingly. We are to give bountifully in that giving. That's the attitude. That attitude of giving is what is that is seen within this time of the year is something that the Christian is to have at all times, throughout the year, and not just at this time of the year. But if you look at this attitude of giving, the spirit of giving characterizes the entirety of the Christian life. When you look at God, in John 3 and verse 16, we're told that God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish but have everlasting life. God's attitude was that of a giving attitude. Now, that giving attitude came out of the love that he had for man, and as a result of that love, he gave. There's that attitude of giving, though. He gave his only begotten Son. We could not have Christianity itself without that attitude of giving that God had for us. When you look at Christ, Christ also had that attitude of a giving type of attitude. In John the 15th chapter, Jesus mentions that greater love hath no man than this, that a man lay down his life for his friends. Ye are my friends, he says, if ye do whatsoever I command you. Laying down his life for his friends, and yet when we look at Jesus, that's exactly what he did. He laid down his life. In fact, it went beyond friendship. He went and he laid down his life even for those who were his enemies. We see that in Romans 5th chapter, verses 5 through verse 10. Paul would write in Galatians 2 and verse 20, that I am crucified with Christ, nevertheless I live, yet not I, but Christ liveth in me, and the life that I now live in the flesh, I live by the faith of the Son of God, who loved me and gave himself for me. He recognized Christ gave his life for me. And there's an aspect in that of a personal attitude that Paul had in relationship to that gift. That if there had been no one else upon this earth, Christ would have died for him and for him alone. That's the way in which Paul is presenting this idea that Christ loved me, and he gave himself for me. We can each say that as well. But there's that attitude of giving that we see in relationship to Christ. In Revelation, the first chapter, in verse 5, as John introduces Christ to us in this book, and the fact that it is being written, this book is being written from first God the Father, the seven spirits, which was the Holy Spirit, and then he says, and from Jesus Christ, who is the faithful witness, the first begotten of the dead, and the prince of the kings of the earth, unto him that loved us and washed us from our sins in his own blood. Christ loves us, and it literally is loves us. He continues to love us. And he washed us from our sins in his own blood. Literally loosed us from our sins by his blood. But he did that by giving himself to die upon the cross. When we look at the Christian life thus, since God the Father is one who gave his only begotten Son, Christ came to this world in giving his life upon the cross for our sins. Thus, we become a partaker of God's divine nature and become givers ourselves. In Romans 12th chapter, verse 1 and verse 2, Paul says, I beseech you therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, that ye present your bodies a living sacrifice, holy, acceptable unto God, which is your reasonable service. And be not conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind, that ye may prove what is that good and acceptable and perfect will of God. Notice, you present your bodies a living sacrifice. What is that? That's nothing but a gift. I'm giving my life as a gift unto God. Now then, a study of Romans, we would see that that act is seen in the act of baptism. When one is baptized into Christ, he is presenting his life to God for God's service, to be a servant of God. And the tense of the verb here, that ye present your bodies a living sacrifice, is a one-time act, in effect, a completed act. It has been completed when you were baptized into Christ. You presented your bodies, and it's going to have now continuing action in relationship to living at holy, acceptable unto God, living sacrifice, because that's our reasonable. The word reasonable is a word that we get logical from. Our logical service. And let me just, as an aside here, there are some, I'll call them translations, that mistranslate this word service with the word worship. Wrong translation. They mistranslate it instead of translating it properly, which would be service. It is service that we offer to God. But there's a gift that we give, the gift of our life. And so the Christian life is a life of giving to others. But also, in relationship to giving, there's also the other aspect, the spirit of receiving. How many of us enjoy receiving gifts? You know, almost ask the question, you almost laugh, because everybody enjoys that, don't they? We enjoy receiving gift. But one thing receiving a gift does is it proves the love of others. It proves that they are thinking about us. And so in receiving the gift, we are in that sense receiving the giver as well. When God the Father gave his only begotten Son, when Christ gave his life, when we receive Christ in the way in which God has set forth for us to receive him, we're receiving God. We're receiving Christ. to a certain extent, that's what Matthew 28, verse 19 is talking about, that in that Great Commission, go, or as you're going, make disciples by baptizing them into that relationship with deity. King James uses in the name of, but it's more correctly into the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. You're coming into a relationship with them. You're receiving them in that act of baptism because of the gift that God has given. And so in receiving that gift, I'm receiving the giver of that gift as well. I'm coming into a relationship with Him. Needless to say, that when we receive gifts from others, you know, we kind of should be expected to show appreciation for that gift that has been given. It's common courtesy simply to say thank you, to set forth that appreciation. In relationship to Christianity, when I receive Christ in that act of baptism, I then live in such a way as to show my appreciation for Christ. I become a servant of Christ. And so our receiving gifts from God, and certainly we can't just simply say the gift of Christ, but all spiritual blessings are in Christ, in the church. Those spiritual blessings show His love for us. From a physical standpoint, we receive the rain, we receive the sun. But those are demonstrations of God's love for those who are His physical children, even though they might not be His spiritual children. As the creator of man, He is interested in all men and has a love for all men. And so as we receive those things, we need to show appreciation for Him because we're receiving Him and receiving those gifts. But when we get into that spiritual realm, we see that in more particular aspect, we have an appreciation for God. We give thanks to Him. In fact, that command to do all in the name of the Lord Jesus, it then adds giving thanks to God and the Father by Him. Colossians 3:17. And so do everything by His authority and give thanks. We are to be a thankful people. Do we show that thankfulness in our prayers? Or do we just run over, thanks for all of the many blessings You've given unto us? We sing the song sometimes, count Your many blessings, name them one by one. Have we ever stopped to try and name them one by one? And if not, why not? Of course, far too many to even name. We realize that. Do we express appreciation for them? What about in the life that we live, though? Do we live a life of thanksgiving to God? That God, by our life, can see that we appreciate that which God has done for us? You know, we have days in which we celebrate victories in war, and even have Memorial Day, in which, to a great extent, we're thanking those individuals who served in the armed forces and gave us in that fighting and that victory, the freedoms that we continue to have. We're expressing thankfulness to them. Sadly, I think a lot of people have forgotten those things. But it is an act of thankfulness. What about our lives? Do we live a life of thankfulness to God? The Israelites were an illustration of just the opposite of that. If you look at, here's Israel in captivity, bondage in Egypt. they cry out unto God, deliver us from this bondage. God sends them Moses and Aaron, and they are delivered out of Egyptian bondage. He takes them, and in their leaving, they receive payment for all of the years that they had been there by, King James I think has the word, borrowing the gold, the silver. Actually, it was the payment that they were receiving for all those years of service. And they plundered the Egyptians. God directs them to the Red Sea. Here's the Egyptian army coming to get them. And so what does God do? He places a flaming fire behind them to separate them so that they cannot reach them. He then opens up the Red Sea for them to cross on dry ground. And when they get to the other side, here comes the Egyptian army following them. And what happens? Waters overflow them, destroy the Egyptian armies. They continue on. They are without water, so God provides them water. They don't have food. God provides them manna. And later on, quail. Their clothes do not wear out. You can continue with all of the blessings that God gives unto the children of Israel during that time. But what did they do? They griped and they complained the entire time. And Paul uses that as an illustration in 1 Corinthians 1 and verse, or chapter 10 and verse 10, when he says, neither murmur ye as some of them also murmured and were destroyed of the destroyer. As we look at all of the spiritual blessings and the physical blessings that we have received at the hand of God, are we a thankful people or do we complain and gripe? Do we murmur as they murmured? Not only is there that spirit of giving and receiving, there's a spirit of forgiveness. During this time of year, many times, those things, those slights, those bumps that we would receive that might cause great conflict at other times of the year are just simply ignored at this time of the year. Why? Because they're that spirit of forgiveness. Slights that someone might feel at another time, just ignored at this time of the year. Families oftentimes are restored that are estranged before during this time of the year, brought back together. It is a fine spirit that we see of forgiveness in the attitude of this world. But again, this is a fundamental doctrine of Christianity. Why would it be lacking at other times as well? We look at God and we want God to forgive us. There's that attitude of forgiveness, though. Now, yes, we have to, and I'm not trying to discount nor ignore the aspect of our obedience and in order to attain that forgiveness, but God is there wanting to forgive. He has that desire to forgive. I'm going to have to repent. I'm going to have to be obedient to God in order to receive that forgiveness. But God has a desire to forgive. That's what you see on the cross as Jesus says, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. Now, we know that they were not forgiven at that point in time because a little bit later on, a few days later, Peter accuses them of doing the very thing that Jesus was praying that they'd be forgiven for. You have by wicked hands taken and crucified the Son of God. He couldn't charge them with that if they had already been forgiven. They were not forgiven, even though Christ demonstrated that attitude of forgiveness. He wanted to forgive them. When they repented, they were forgiven. Repent and be baptized. In Matthew, the 18th chapter, starting in verse 21, Jesus gives a great lesson about forgiveness. When Peter comes to him and asks him, Lord, how often shall my brother sin against me and I forgive him? Till seven times? Now, according to Jewish tradition, you only had to forgive a person three times and then you didn't have to forgive him anymore. And so Peter was going not only double that, but then added one to it. And of course, Jesus says, no, not seven times, but 70 times seven. And as has been correctly pointed out through the years, that does not mean that we start keeping tally and when we reach 491, we don't have to forgive anymore. It's dealing with that attitude of forgiveness. You have always that attitude of forgiveness. And then he gave a parable of a king who had a servant who couldn't pay him, and he forgave his debt. An amount of money that was inconceivable as far as the amount, as far as it being paid back. Impossibility. And yet he forgave him the debt. And yet that same servant goes out, and a man who owes him just a small piddling of amount. And he beats him, he casts him into prison until he pays all of it. He didn't return that forgiving spirit and attitude that he had had the desire for his master to show him and that his master did show him. And so his master calls him back in. He's angry with him. Delivers him, he says, to the tormentors till all of it would be paid that was due him. And then the conclusion of that in verse 35, so likewise shall my heavenly Father do also unto you if ye from your heart forgive not every one his brother their trespasses. Our attitude of forgiveness is necessary for Christianity. If we want to be Christians, if we want to be forgiven by God, we're going to have that forgiving attitude. That doesn't mean we forgive without those individuals meeting those conditions of forgiveness, which is repentance. Luke 17 and verse 3. And even in this parable. But yet, we have that attitude that of a desire to forgive. But then there's also the spirit of kindness, fellowship, love. Children for their parents, parents for their children. Employers, employees, and on you can go. You see that type of an attitude of kindness one toward another. Love one toward another, being demonstrated. It's interesting that even during wars, here's two armies fighting each other, and on Christmas Day, many times they would call a truce. They would even get together and eat together on the day of Christmas, and then afterwards they would go back to their fighting each other. Because there was that type of an attitude of Christmas. But again, that type of an attitude should always prevail in relationship to Christianity and us as Christians. And then the spirit of joy. This time of year, people seem to, and this of course isn't universal, but generally speaking, people are just bubbling over with joy. One of the joyous times of their lives is during this time period. People go around singing or humming, whistling. Some of them that are singing, we wish were whistling. No, we understand. People are singing and they're just joyous because of the time of year that it is. People get together and go out singing Christmas carols. And again, it's a spirit of joy that is there. Spirit of happiness because of the time of the year. But again, the spirit of joy is the spirit of Christianity. In John the 14th chapter, as Jesus draws his apostles to him, he begins by telling them, "Let not your heart be troubled. You believe in God, believe also in me." There is an attitude that Christ is setting forth for these apostles. Don't let your heart be troubled. There's an attitude of joy and peace that is found within that statement that many times we lose within Christianity. It's almost sometimes as if we're saying, y'all need to come and be Christians with us and be just as miserable as we are. Because we, a lot of times, forget to tell our face that we're joyous. Paul would write it to the Philippian brethren in chapter 4 and verse 4, "Rejoice in the Lord always." Again, I say rejoice. There's a joy that is to be found being in Christ. That's the joy that we see demonstrated by so many people this time of the year. A spirit of Christianity. But that spirit is seen so many times in this time of year with so many individuals. But it is, in reality, the spirit of Christianity. What we are seeing at this time of the year, these 1-2 weeks, is that man is trying to live up to the standards of Christ within his life. He's demonstrating those attitudes that Christ would have us to have. And thus we see the kindness, the demonstrations of love and joy that we see within our life. How much better would it be, though, for the world and for us if we demonstrated those attitudes 365 days out of the year. Every day of the year, we had those attitudes and demonstrated them. We had that joy that we find that's in Christ Jesus. When we obey the gospel of Jesus Christ, they rejoiced. It was joyous. Why? Because their sins were forgiven. They can start again. They become a new creature. Old things are passed away. Behold, all things are become new. It's what Paul says in 2 Corinthians 5 and verse 17. We now have no condemnation in Christ. We have salvation. We are receiving the grace of God, 2 Timothy 2 verse 1 and verse 10. But it's in Christ that's found. Rejoice in the Lord. We get into Christ through that act of baptism, Romans 6 and verse 3 and Galatians 3 and verse 27. Predicated upon our faith, our repentance, and our confession of our faith. But as we live in Christ, as we live that Christian life, we can rejoice. Why? Because we're in Christ. We're recipients of all of those spiritual blessings that God gives unto His children. We are an heir of God and a joint heir with Christ. And we have the hope of an eternity with God throughout all eternity if we will live faithful to Him. When we fall away, God says there's a way in which you can come back unto me if you will repent of your sins and pray, and you can come back. And you can be restored to that faithfulness, and you can enjoy once again the joys of salvation. You need to come this morning to have that joy that Christ gives unto us. And why not come as we stand and sing the invitation song?